If you've been following the videos on this playlist in order, you've already asked questions, generated a hypothesis, planned and carried out an investigation, analyzed your data using mathematics, and you've constructed an explanation for what happened to the fish on the Ogeechee River. That's a lot. Now we'll put all of this together with our last two science and engineering practices. Practice number 7, engaging in argument from evidence. This one might be the most fun, because who doesn't enjoy a good argument once in a while? Of course, this is not the kind of argument you might see on reality TV shows. Remember, in science, an argument is based on reason and evidence. Lastly, we'll use practice number 8, communicating information. So let's get to it.
Now that you've taken some time to make a display board with your guiding question, your claim, and the evidence you're using, at the bottom of the display, you should have listed possible concerns to the economy or to health, or maybe legal or political concerns. Now it's time to argue using evidence. Each team will present their display boards. Team 1 can go first.
Our claim was that it was a base that caused the fish kill. The evidence shows that the area where the fish were killed became alkaline, not acid. So we rejected our first hypothesis.
Yes, rejecting your first hypothesis is fine. Remember that science is constantly self-correcting process. We reject ideas if there's no evidence to support them.
We reason that the King America Finishing Company might be a responsible party and may have to clean up and restore the river. So they may need to come up with a plan to prevent future spills also.
Those are great ideas. Let's hear from team 2.
Well, we used a color graph to display our data. Is that okay?
Sure, I can understand your data using the colors. Did you display averages for each river station like we did?
Yeah, and we thought a color graph might show what was happening between stations. Our data is qualitative, so we don't have numbers to graph. We did a graph based on color changes we saw. Our evidence shows a change to alkaline water in the area around and downstream from King America Finishing Company. So we rejected our first hypothesis too. We said we thought the fish kill might have been caused by an alkali chemical spill.
Yeah, but we weren't sure if that's enough evidence. I mean, how do you know what killed the fish? We think it's a good idea to get more information about what other chemicals might have been in the water, like fertilizer. Maybe something else killed the fish too. We were concerned that if a lot of people are employed at King Finishing and they had to close down because of the fish kill, a lot of people might lose their jobs. All the families in the area would really suffer.
Right, and we are also concerned about long-term environmental damage. Maybe there should be some outside group brought in so they can monitor the water in the river all the time. Maybe there needs to be research done on alternate chemical methods to do what King America Finishing does. Maybe there's a different way to do what they do.
Good job. Now I've got a few questions for you. Most importantly, you all first wrote that you thought the fish kill might have been caused by an acid spill. Does your evidence support your original hypothesis?
No, our evidence showed that it was most likely a base that got into the water and killed the fish.
Okay. In that case, your evidence does not support your original hypothesis. Can you tell us again why rejecting a hypothesis is okay?
I think I can. It's the evidence that really matters. Once you measure pH and gather evidence, the evidence tells you whether your hypothesis was supported or not.
Right, and that's fine. A no answer is as good as a yes answer, because we've learned something. The experimental evidence gives us a lot of information as to what happened in the river. Here, the evidence shows that a base might be causing the fish kill. We now know something we didn't know before.
As you just saw with our students in this video, professional scientists make their conclusions after a great deal of experimentation. Sometimes they even go back and change hypotheses, and then run a whole new set of tests and experiments. When the results of the experiments show that the predictions of the hypotheses are supported by evidence, scientists go a step further and publish their results and conclusions so that other scientists can use the information. Science isn't effective if no one communicates its results. The display boards you made are a great start as you begin to communicate using the language of science. As you know, this experiment was based on an actual event that occurred in Georgia's Ogeechee River in 2011. So let's learn a little more about how your experiment could be useful in the real world, outside of the classroom. To do that, I sat down and spoke with attorney Don Stack to learn more about what actually happened.
Hi, Don. Thanks for joining us today.
Thank you.
If you would, just give us a really brief introduction to the events that occurred in May 2011 on the Ogeechee River.
Sure. Yeah, right before Memorial Day in 2011, people in the area noticed a great number of fish dying off right below the King America finishing discharge pipe in Dover, Georgia. And over the next week or so, they noticed that it continued to migrate down, this number of fish, and ultimately we ended up with the largest fish kill, the most devastating fish kill in the entire history of Georgia.
And it wasn't just fish. There were other types of animals that were killed as well.
In fact, there was just about any animal that lives in the water was affected, from microvertebrate all the way up to larger things. You didn't have, you know, the impacts on alligators and like that because they can move out of that water. But anything that actually lives in the water was being affected.
And is there an approximate count of numbers of animals that were killed?
Well, and everybody talks about 38,000 fish, but that really didn't include probably the more important things, which hadn't been addressed, which is sort of all the species that lead up to the fish in that food chain. Mm-hmm, and mm-hmm. So that was significant.
Sure. And about how far downstream did the kill continue?
You could see impacts almost about 70, 75 miles, because what would happen is you could actually see it migrate from day to day, and you would see the impact. So like on day one of the fish kill, for example, mm-hmm. it would be, you know, within a few miles, and then the slug, for lack of a better word, would actually migrate downstream. And so it lasted about 70 miles.
Now, how can we know for certain that it was the chemicals that caused the fish kill and not another a bacterial infection or another biological event?
Well, I think the easiest way is to look at it, and I think the students have learned about the difference between qualitative data and quantitative mm-hmm. data. Well, qualitatively, it was pretty easy. Qualitatively, you could say, well, there were no fish dead above the discharge pipe, mm-hmm. okay? All the fish were below that, okay? Quantitatively, you can also look at the data that was acquired. pH above the river, above the discharge point was within normal limits of a blackwater stream. pH below that was significantly higher. You had readings up to 9, 9.5. In a blackwater stream, you would think you're going to be looking at about 6.5, maybe 7. Mm-hmm. So you put those two together, it becomes pretty evident pretty quickly, or at least to people who were looking at it objectively, that the King America site was the source of the problem.
Now, we may not think of chemistry as something you'd need to be an attorney,
right.
And yet it's obviously helped you in this case.
Oh, absolutely. The ability to interpret data is critical. Hmm. Whether or not you understand pH, you know, that's important. But also, I think what's important is that chemistry and sciences as a whole give people, or give students and lawyers a way of thinking about things, about the way they evaluate problems, problem solving. I have attorneys who have science backgrounds, and I have attorneys who work for me who have English and political science backgrounds, and I will tell you that there is a big difference between how they view problem solving. And so I think chemistry is an absolutely essential part of being a good lawyer.
So it's important what's going on in these classrooms right now.
Absolutely, yes.
So
absolutely.
Do your homework and listen to your teacher.
Exactly right, yep.
All right.
I want to thank Don Stack for helping us get a better understanding of how chemistry can be used in careers and places you might not expect to see it. And thanks to you for watching and participating in Unit 1 of Chemistry Matters. I hope you were able to get a solid handle on the 8 science and engineering practices. To review, they include asking questions and defining problems, developing models, planning and carrying out investigations, analyzing and interpreting data, using mathematics and computational thinking, constructing explanations and designing solutions, engaging in argument from evidence, and obtaining, evaluating, and communicating information. Not only are these tools that we'll be using throughout this series, they're also a great way to see how chemistry has real-world applications and implications well beyond your classroom, but more about that in future episodes. Don't forget, you can further explore scientific notation and significant figures with our Unit 1 Closer Look videos. And you'll find more information from Georgia's Department of Natural Resources about the Ogeechee River fish kill in our Chemistry Matters toolkit. While you do that, I'll get to work on Unit 2, Introduction to Matter, and see you there.